gotta go pick corn. Before we start this morning, I want to welcome a visitor, very important visitor, as far as I'm concerned, because I don't have to give the homework. We have a guest pastor, and the name is Connie Manns. She's here with her husband, Kevin. They're from Grovertown. They have, I guess, one daughter, Tanner. Bless you. She is probably going to be with us for a couple months. So this is an opportunity to meet a new pastor. She's not our permanent one yet, but she will be here mentoring us. So please, when you get a chance, if you haven't already done it, stop by and introduce yourself. I'm sure she would like to meet you. I reassure her that overall as a congregation, we're pretty good. She's got a lot of people willing to be led. And we kept Pound Sign away from last morning, so that's fine. So, without further ado,
I think I take that personally. You should.
Let's get along.
Look around you this morning. Come on, look around. Look at people around you. Does the sight of some of these people put a smile on your face? Now, wait a minute. That was a nasty one. I'm not really sure what that laugh was about, but for one reason or another, these are the people who have joined you today in worship. I am a teacher, so Webster defines worship as the act of showing respect and love for God, especially by praying with other people who believe in the same God. Let us join together in worship this morning with the people who believe around us. We stand and sing.
Time to be glorified. God, just as you are to worship. I just want to extend an invitation to join the choir. And I know what most of your guys' answers will be. I don't sing. I'm tone deaf. You really don't want me. Since I have a little bit of a platform, I'll get to share with you some of my personal beliefs about music and the church. It's a place where you learn to sing. It's a place where you learn to use your voice. That's where I first started singing. When I was 3 years old, my parents just put me on stage, and I sang Nothing But the Blood of Jesus. And I think you'll agree, we don't come to church because we're perfect. We don't come to church because we know everything about our faith. So it's the same with music. You don't have to come to choir rehearsal knowing everything and having a perfect voice, but you can be there to learn. So I really encourage you to come, especially in this day and age where we are catering to the world around us. Our culture is pulling us down. Music and the church is a place to bring us to a higher standard. So I'd really love if as many people as possible could help bring the world up to that standard. So please join us on Wednesdays at 7 o'clock. Thank you.
I don't even know the trick. We stand up now. Everybody stand. Please join me in our call to worship, followed by the patient man. We're going to sing three of our faithfuls at our first hymn this morning. All that we knew, where we could find the Lord.
Then we would lay our case before our God.
Then we would lay our case before God. Excuse me. That we might learn how the Lord would answer us.
And hear what our God would say to us.
Will the Lord contend with us in the greatness of divine power?
No, our God will give heed to our cry.
O God, in your sight, thousands of years are solitary yesterday. We would be consumed by such a vision of eternity,
so hard and long and mysterious and profound.
Yet you would consume us,
desiring that we see the world as you do. How hard it is to think of your kingdom.
Look upon us with love, Lord. We dream of this heavenly treasure,
all the while keeping one eye suggestions. Send your word to strike softly our eyes and to pierce sharply our hearts. Let us be dismayed at the sight of you and go away
Thank you. and we just don't always give back even a minute part of what you give to us. So we give you praise and glory this morning for a beautiful Sunday morning and the beautiful artwork you're doing within our skies and within our trees, Lord. We're thankful for that. We're thankful, Lord, for answered prayers. You are so wonderful in listening to us and giving us the desires of your heart, of our heart, when it's in your will, Lord, and we thank you for that. We lift up these prayer requests, Lord, and we just lay them at your feet. There's so much wrong in our world, and we just know that basically all we can do is hand it to you. We're not strong enough to deal with it within our own ways. And our ways are never right compared to yours. We're thankful, Lord, for our firefighters and our EMS and all those people out there doing services, Lord. We thank you for those. It takes special talent. Not everybody could face the things that they face and be able to deal with it. So we thank you, Lord, for them and the things that they do. We pray, Lord, for the Emmaus walk. What a wonderful time with you. What a beautiful way to draw closer to you, Lord. And we just lift this group up to you, Lord, and say, have your will with them and with this walk. Again, we thank you, Lord, for just everything that you do for us. We hand this service to you. It is your service, Lord. Do with it what you would have done. We say all this and more to it than our hearts as we pray the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Texas visiting my daughter for a week, about 1,000 miles south of here, and it was much warmer down there than it is here last Sunday morning. When I came back home, I could see a big change in just a week. Here in Indiana, I could really tell that fall was coming. How do you know fall's coming? How can you tell? Getting kind of cold sometimes at night. The leaves are starting to fall, exactly. Anything else you notice? Do you notice any changes in color of the leaves? Yes? Oh, that's a sure sign it's fall. It's almost Halloween, for sure. Look at all these. Wow, look at all these beautiful fall leaves. Everybody find one. Can you find a leaf you want and pick it up? How many different colors do we have here? I had to look a little because they haven't really changed a lot yet, have they? No. Fall is one of the most colorful times of the year. Everybody get a leaf? Find a leaf to hold? Find one you like? Get lots of leaves. Some of the things are here too. There you go. Here's the brown one. Okay. You like that one? Every tree has its... Fall is one of the most colorful times of the year because of the leaves. In the fall, leaves turn from their usual green color to every shade of red, and orange, and yellow, and brown, and even some are kind of purple if you look at them carefully. Each tree has its own unique shape. Can you turn around here so I can see your handsome face? Look at those leaves. Do you notice how they each have their shape? Those little round ones there are from a birch tree, and they're kind of yellow, usually. And those maple, those leaves there with the pointy fingers, those are maple leaves. And they turn shades of orange and red. Look how red that one is. It's really red, isn't it? Yeah. Well, that's the one with the pointy fingers, the maple leaf. The brown ones there are from the oak tree, and the burning bush has those bright red ones, those little ones there. Leaves are amazing. Did you know leaves make the food for the trees? I knew that. I knew that. Well, maybe. Trees take in water from their roots and carbon dioxide from the air. And leaves use the sunlight to turn the carbon dioxide and water into a kind of sugar called glucose. That's what trees and other plants eat. They need it to grow, and without leaves, they couldn't get glucose. The whole process is called, does anybody know already? Photosynthesis. You may have learned about it in school already. But let me tell you something else about these leaves.
And right here,
some really green ones didn't turn yet. Do you see those? What makes these leaves green? Do you know? What do you think makes them green? Water helps, that's right. It wouldn't be very green if we didn't have water, that's true. Well, in these leaves, they're filled with chlorophyll. These leaves are green because they have chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is a chemical that helps the leaves do their job. Chlorophyll is green, and that's why the leaves are green in the summertime. Why did they change color then in the winter? That has a lot to do with it turning colder. That's one reason they aren't so bright right now, because we haven't had very much cold weather. But in fall and winter, the days are shorter, and the weather is colder. And when the days are shorter, there's not as much light for the leaves to make food. So they take a rest, and they stop making food. They let their trees live off of the glucose that was stored up inside them in the spring and the summertime. The green chlorophyll disappears, and then the leaves turn all those beautiful colors, like the ones that you're holding in your hands. The beautiful leaves we see in fall are showing their true colors. The yellows, the oranges, and the reds were there all along. They're just covered by the chlorophyll, and so they look green in the summertime.
These green leaves look a lot alike.
That I have in my hand here. So you can't really tell much difference, can you?
They kind of look like the same leaf over and over again, don't they? But the leaves that you're holding, if you look at them very carefully, there's no two that are exactly alike. It might be pretty close, but not exactly. And when you go to school and are with your friends, you might really want to kind of blend in with the kids at school and try to be like everybody else. But God wants us to show our true colors like the leaves in the fall. If we are Christians and we belong to Him, He wants us to follow His teachings. What are some things He might want us to remember to do? Can you think of some things? Yes. To be kind to everyone in your life, she said. Very good. What else might He want us to remember to do? Yes. Say hello. Be friendly to everybody. That's a good idea. Always think about other people first. If you see somebody fall down on the playground or somebody needs help, give them a hand. What if you see somebody being picked on or bullied by somebody else? What should you do then if you're following Jesus' teachings? Just stand, yes. Stand up for Him. It's not always easy. It's easier to be like the green leaves and just kind of blend in, isn't it? Than to show your true colors. You need to follow the rules at home and at school and to treat everybody with respect. Instead of trying to blend in like the green leaves this fall, show your true colors. That's what makes fall beautiful, and that's what will make you beautiful, too. Let's pray. Dear God, You make every leaf that we're holding in our hands right now, and You make each one of us. Help us to show our true colors by living lives that You would want us to. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hear these words of wisdom. This is how one should regard us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. Think about this truth as you return your gifts to the Lord. You please stand and join me in a prayer of meditation. Dear Lord, we have gathered our gifts together in this offering.
Alone we are weak, together we are strong. Let your strong will be exercised through these gifts, which we dedicate in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
They share 10 ways to become more confident in your life. yourself has an enormous impact on how others perceive you. Perception is reality. The more self-confidence you have, the more likely you are to succeed. Now, do you want me to let me know?
Or let you know what those 10 things are? That's okay.
Technology. Sounds like you're underwater.
Sounds like you're underwater. Probably, yeah. No. If you can, if you haven't figured it out by now, I love to have fun, and I'm really good at laughing at me. I think I'm the biggest joke. Thank you. I don't know what I'd do without the fire behind me. I mean, good grief. Anyway, the top 10 things that they say that we need to do in order to be successful is, number one, dress sharp. The next one I went, huh? And it was walk faster. I don't walk faster very well, and I keep squeaking. Is it something I can do? Ooh, let's not do that. Is it my iPad?
It's not on the screen, but it's not on the... It's fine. We'll get it.
We will.
Speak directly into the
mic. Okay, let's try this.
Is it working?
Take three. Here we go.
Maybe. Okay. Number one, dress sharp. Number two, walk faster. That one I still don't understand. I read it over and over. I don't know why we're supposed to walk faster, but that's supposed to make us more successful. I'm doomed for failure then. Maintain good posture. Be grateful for your success. Compliment others. Sit in the front row. Work out and contribute. These are the 10 things that are supposed to make us more successful. But what does one do when their life is totally exposed? I stand before you this morning feeling a little bit exposed. I don't know you, you don't know me, and it just kind of feels a little weird, right? Well, imagine what it would feel like to be totally exposed. The Bible relates that God knows us from even before we were created. All of our days are revealed to the Creator. In finishing his description in Psalm 95:1-11, where Israel failed to enter God's rest, the writer concludes, we know who the writer was, right? David. Concludes this section with a warning that is both sobering and comforting. He lets us know that nothing gets by God. But rather than being fearful of what God knows about us, we have the confidence when everything is exposed. So, let's read Hebrews 4:12-16. It says, "For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attributes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who is ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. The Bible and the writer of Hebrews reminds us that we are exposed to God, before God. Verses 12 and 13 said, "For we, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword." Thought seriously today about bringing a double-edged sword, but I couldn't find it. I think it's in storage. Another whole long story we won't go into. If you've ever seen a double-edged sword, they can be somewhat frightful. And it's sharper than a double-edged sword. And it penetrates even to the to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. Notice that the writer shares that the Word of God is living and active. You know, I got into a conversation this weekend between black and white. Some people love to see the world as black and white. I like to say I see things in gray. It has that gray area. I was informed by the time it was all over this week this weekend that I was also a very black and white person, at least where the Bible is concerned. This is very black and white. He is alive and He is active. This is important because either there are those who think God does not know or does not care. This is simply not the case. His word is living and active. He is therefore making the case that Jesus is alive and still very much active in the life of those who have placed their faith in Him. Christ, the author, the sum and substance of all things, is the living God. Not a thing, but a living person who is a critical discerner of the secrets of man, of men's hearts. The fact that the Word of God is sharper than any double-edged sword and penetrates even to dividing the soul and spirit, joints and marrows, it judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Not only are the words of God active, but His Son, our Savior, is as well. We know that by the words of His mouth, by the power of His Spirit, and the efficiency of His grace, He makes us holy. Praise God. His words are sharper, or as sharp as a double-edged sword. Out of His mouth come teachings with piercings of the hearts of man. It cuts them to the quick. It lays their souls open. God ever get you to that point? You ever been so chastised by the Lord that you know without a shadow of a doubt that it's God and you must stop doing what you are doing or change what you are doing? Excuse me, I've got allergies really bad. Everything is uncovered and laid before the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. All people everywhere, including all Christians, will stand one day before the Word of God and judged by Him. Paul related that each of us will give an account of himself to God in Romans 14:12. And that the believer's work will be shown for what it is, because that day will bring it to light. That's from 1 Corinthians 3:13. The author of Hebrews makes it plain that we are exposed completely before God. We could be fearful of facing a holy and majestic God, but we quickly discover from Hebrews that God sympathizes with us. When I was working on this sermon, that went through my head. As I'm writing these verses out and I'm pulling it together, I thought, man, that day can make me shake in my boots than standing up here in front of you guys this morning. So consequently, I need hope, right? I've brought out all the scariness of it. We need some hope. But God sympathizes with us. Verses 14 and 15 says, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are. Yet he is without sin. That's Hebrews 4, 14 to 15. There is wonderful news, however, for the Christian. The writer continues by telling us, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we possess. Gotta stand for something, or we fall for anything. So if we're going to profess being Christians, if we're going to say, I am a Christian, I am a child of God, we must hold steadfast to that. How can we do that if God knows so much about us? We can because we need not fear the sharp sword of God. Because by his word, our great high priest, Jesus, has made us complete. Just as Jesus holds us, we can hold firmly to the faith we possess. In fact, Jesus is the great high priest of all because of the wonder of his grace, the virtue of his sacrifice, and because of the place he now resides at the right hand of God. Jesus is the greatest high priest. All earthly high priests had to pass the test and go through the curtain of the temple. Jesus has gone through the heavens, where none of them could ever go. But more than that, we have a high priest who is able to sympathize with our weaknesses. Jesus is not someone who is so far above the rest of us that he is unable to sympathize. As Paul would wonder, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing. Take the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's Philippians 2, 6 to 8. Therefore, the astonishing truth is, we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he was without sin. While God cuts through the fog of our lives and knows our insides and outs, we can remain confident because God sympathizes with us. I don't know about you, but I do not like politicians. Sorry.
Amen.
I got an amen on that. And no one truly knows what is going on within our lives, if he hasn't lived our lives. I can't tell you what each one of you are going through and how you should feel if I haven't walked a mile in your shoes. But time and time again, we have these politicians going, I promise your life is going to get better. While they're making how much? I don't even know. Don't tell them. And they don't make it just for the term that they're there. They're making it the rest of their lives. And most of the time they've had millions of dollars before they ever started into politics. But they know how I feel. Mm-hmm. Not. A huge impersonal government can never know what the common man feels. Government cannot feel our pain. Nor can it solve the sinful conditions of the human heart. But God can. Here in Hebrews, we are reminded that we are following a Savior who knows our circumstances because he has lived our circumstances. He's walked a mile in our shoes. Rather than being fearful of God, we can be confident because God sympathizes with us. We know God cares for us. The writer of Hebrews goes on to share that we can be confident in approaching God. Hebrews 4:16 says, let us then approach the throne of God, the throne of grace, with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Dear children of the Lord, this is the greatest truth of all. That we, sinful as we are, can come before the throne of God. As Paul would remind us, as it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. How sad. That's basically where our world is going. No one. And as Christians, if we stand back and allow this to happen, then we aren't doing our jobs either, are we? It takes guts to stand up for those things that the Bible says are true. Yet Hebrews declares, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, not only to approach it, but boldly, confidently approach it. The author is reminding us to have no fear, no trembling, and no wondering if God truly loves us or not. How is this possible? The beautiful miracle is that all who trust in Christ can confidently approach the throne of grace. God's throne has become to us a throne of grace through the meditation of our high priest at God's right hand. Now take a moment to take in this beautiful fact, this one gorgeous truth. We don't have to be perfect. My daughter loves to say to me, Mom, there's one perfect man in the world and we've crucified him. We didn't just kill him. We crucified him. So I'm not sure that we want to be perfect. That intimidates the rest, and guess what that gets us. But no matter what our lives are like, no matter what sin we struggle with, and no matter how we may feel at the time, we are the long-suffering Christian, and we may come to God, the great throne of grace, at any time. It harkens back to the compassionate words of Jesus when he related, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks the door will be opened. Matthew 7:7-8. Paul would write, do not be anxious for anything. I'm still working on that one, by the way. But in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ. The way to the throne has been opened, and our way paved by the blood of the Lamb of God. Nothing blocks our way to the mercy seat. We can be confident in approaching God. We are supposed to be before God, yet God sympathizes with us, and we therefore can be confident in approaching God. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you for being such a wonderful God. God that can sympathize with just the simplest of problems or the biggest of temptations. We praise you and we give you glory for the beautiful way that you deal with us. You are such an awesome God. We just pray, Lord, that you continue to work in our lives. Pray, Lord, that you lead and guide us the way you would have us. Put it in our hearts to desire to follow your will and to invite people to your house. In your most beautiful, precious name we pray. Amen.
In Luke chapter 10, you hear the story of Mary and Martha. And I think you know the song. Or you know the song. You know the word of the story. I'll get out. So I'm just going to go with two verses. 41 and 42 say, Martha, Martha, Lord, the Lord answered, you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Jesus wants us not to worry about the little things, but to always strive to become closer to him.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire.
Understanding, shall you keep in your hearts, in your minds, through Christ Jesus.